Yes, ma'am. Please continue.
Good morning to one and all. I, Heba Farin, an academic consultant in English of Odisha State Open University, and we are having an online session for our graduate students. And today's topic is British Prose 18th Century, Joseph Edison's Essay, Sixth Paper on Wit. So before starting with the essay, first of all, we need to know the very concept behind this formulation of the periodical essays and the concept of wit according to 18th century prose writer, especially Joseph Edison. So Edison sketched out this schema of the, there are varieties of wit, and he wrote this particularly in 1711 in the issue of the Spectator. And Edison had an inspiration from a distinction as he came across the writings of the John Locke between the judgment and wit. And for John Locke, judgment was a capacity for discerning fine differences, while wit was a capacity of finding similarities. So then he concluded that the tittering wits of London were not likely to have any sort of good judgment, while it was like a sage and sober men of judgment who were unlikely to crack a smile at bon mot. So that was a later being, that was a prospect of a little terrifying manner of finding a distinction between the two. And Edison too praised Locke for his elaborate notion of wit and the capacity to find the similarities, and telling us that there's more to it than just noticing that one mistress eyes being bright are like the sun. So it's just not like the comparison. We need to find in that the in-depth meaning or the very sort of intelligence that is required in drawing the similarity of the ideas as well. So there are different types of wit that we will be coming across this essay. So there are true wit, there are false wit, there are even mixed wit is also being discussed over here. So true wit, according to him, in his views, it involves a substantial resemblances of ideas, like drawing of the compass with that of the similarity with the human anatomy, while false wit involves resemblance of word or just a verbal element. So true wit consists of resemblance plus congruity of ideas, and false wit just takes the form like a single letter that we say anagrams, chronograms, lipograms, acrostics. So these are the certain terms that has been used in his essays too, in order to display that how we try to just run after the similarity or we waste our time behind this, and there's no sort of creativity in these works, and we just fancy, we run about these works, and it's not, and we are busy with nothing. That was his line in one of his essay in the Six Papers of Wit. And sometimes we run after the syllable, as in echoes or doggerel rhymes. So some of the words such as pun, quibble, these sorts of and makes a whole sentence of the poem, and such as the figures like egg, axis, altar. So these are the different figures that has been used in order to explain us that how the very notion of wit that has been divided into the true and false, and it has been displayed in this manner. So we can take the example of John Donne's valediction, forbidding morning, in which it's a true wit, while that of the George Herbert Easter Wings, how the very pattern of the poem is written in a form of a wing itself. So it would act as a false wit. It would act as a punster. So this was the way that Edison tries to display the very metaphysical notions, metaphysical poets, their notion of writing the poetry in the form of a structure, whether it be in the form of an axe, whether it be form of an altar, or in the form of a wing. So these were the way that they tried to display their wit in different manner. And particularly, Edison was concerned much about the value of the word. So the very resemblances of ideas in true wit and the verbal resemblances of a false wit, it normally lied between the mixed wit. That was a species that has a combination of both the resemblance of ideas with verbal resemblance. Such wit, according to Edison, it's a combination of pun plus true wit, and is more or less perfect, as the resemblance lies in ideas or words and not just on the images. and its foundation laid partly in falsehood and partly in truth even, because the reason that he claimed was that, and that was an extravagance for the other. So Edison, his ideas on the wit and how the English used to compromise with this aspect can be found out through the different events that took place in the end of the 18th century England, and how it was developing as a mercantile society that was vibrant as any in the Europe. And there was lots and lots of fortune that was made in the trade of textiles, paper and metals. And there was a financial revolution though in 1690 as well that really allowed a new elite group based on trade and finance rather than land to emerge. And even there was a Bank of England, there's a founding of the stock market and national debt. So the last of which, it gives an unprecedented rise of power and influence to the creditor in public credit. So there was a new group of elite that rose up, and there was an aristocratism, and there was an inheritance of the privilege. So these laid the foundation. And England being fortunate enough, so there was no sort of legal barrier of mixing of the new elite with the established one. So it was a quite an amalgamation of the elite of bourgeois and the aristocrats. So there was a mixing together of the both. So in this essay, so beginning, so let's start with the essay. Hopefully you people might be having the essay in hand so that we can get a good idea, or that would be able to understand things clearly. So as the very first paper begins, that there's a poems are like a picture, so that poems are itself a portrayal of images. And the reason behind writing this essay, he says that if a person gives his a week, it's a essay that's written in a week, that's a six days of a week it has been taken into consideration. And through his essays, he is trying to make a speculation in order to banish the very vices, ignorances that do exist in the society. And it is his polite way of writing this. And he's trying to relate things to the very concept of the operas and tragedies. And from time to time, how the very notion of comedy and the refinement and perception do change. And it would act as a paper for some bookseller. These papers would be acting as a criticism with the sense of humor. But when it was received with different perception of the different people's notion. And here he tries to trace the very history of the false wit, and even tries to distinguish several things as have prevailed in different ages of the world. And he even tried to revise some of the antiquated modes of wit that had been exploded out of the Commonwealth of Letters. So there may be several satires, panegyrics, and that was handed out in an acrostic. So these were the main motive was the ambitious thought that the writer takes into account and is set up to be a polite author. So writer doesn't show himself as a man of beautiful genius, but rather to be a man of great industry, because he would be utilizing his intelligence in composing all these works. Rather, poetry is something which is spontaneous and runs spontaneously. But when a person utilizes his genius or the sort of thinking when it's required, it changes its form. Like if a person takes into consideration that he will be composing a poem in the form of an oval shaped poem, or in the shape of a scissor, or in the shape of the wings, the very sense of creativity, what we say as a sense of genius, is quite minimized in that aspect. So this is the way that he is trying to portray things in this manner. Even the very use of lipograms, anagrams, the very sort of cutting down some of the alphabets, like the very adventurous poem, epic poem that was written, Odysseus, or the adventure of the Ulysses, how the very letter one by one in the 24 books that was written in each book, each alphabet was reduced to, in some of the books. In the first book, as we know, that the alpha was missing. There was no use of alpha or the A. And in the second, there was no use of B. So it was quite intentionally done. So in the process, when something is done intentionally, or when lots and lots of thinking is required, especially in the realm of poetry or the creative realm. So according to him, it is just an imitation, or it's not that creative what he says. And in the manner, he says that the very notion of true wit and the false wit is portrayed. Like the example that he cites, the innumerable citation that he refers to. He says that when the poetry was to contract or dilate itself according to the mold in which it was cast. So originally, or the very reason behind the formation of the poem is in the manner that we want to. So there would be a stretching when required. There would be chopping of the sum of the parts. Like, so it loses its very essence of the poeticness. Then, even the reference to Caesar, Julius Caesar, that one of the master of the Roman mint. So even he was, so at the time he wasn't able to portray his image on the coin. So at the time, the very representation of his image was signified by the elephant in the Punic language. And in the time of the Cicero, there was a mark on the nose with a little wench, or the wench that was used. So different figures that were used to represent something totally different. So sometimes the figure of the frogs and lizard that too were used in the buildings. So this way the architecture used to pay homage to the person concerned with the representation of the different images. So the truth of it is that man had better be a galley slave than wit, where one to gain the title of the elaborate trifles, which have been the inventions of such authors as were often masters of great. So whenever they try to frame the lipogrammatics or the letter dropper, it without any reason against some particular letter, so it's admit that the ones it changes the whole structure or the pattern of the work. So these are the, so there are totally six papers on the wit. So we are heading towards the next one, and how the different each paper tries to portray in itself a different heading towards in a gradually towards the explanation of the according to him the wit actually was. So just a minute. So we can say that there was four different methods of defining wit that has been represented in Spectator series. So the first one is analytical method that consisted in separating what Edison calls false, true, and mixed wit. Then secondly, we have historical method, that is by tracing the history of wit from classical through Gothic and modern times. Thirdly, we are applying the conventional categories of neoclassical criticism in wit, that is the first race of authors who were the great heroes in writing, now were the destitutes of all rules and arts of criticism. And for that reason, Though they have excelled as a writers in greatness and genius, but they fall short in accuracy and correctness. And fourthly, we have the method of searching for the psychological explanations, as Edison contrasts in one of his definition with Dryden's definition of wit as a propriety of words and thought applied to the subject. So, beginning with his first essay on wit, Edison's main motive is to establish a taste for polite writing, and he proceeds to set out a plan to trace out. So, the beginning with the history of the false wit, and he distinguishes the several kinds of wit as they have prevailed in different ages of the world. So, he is motivated by the fear of revival of those antiquated modes of wit that have been long exploded out of the commonwealth of letters. And because lately there have been several satires and panegyrics that was handed about in acrostics, by which means some of the most errant, undisputed blockheads about the town began to entertain ambitious thought and to set up for polite authors. So in this single sentence, Edison tries to identify some of the important things. So one of the most poetic form of false wit is acrostic, that is a poem in which the first letter of the syllable of the word of each line or the spell out a word or a message. So that is associated with the false wit and with the genre of satire and panegyric. And most significantly, still his true motivation for tracing out the history of false wit. So false wit is closely associated with those who try to set up for polite author, that is, would be writers or artists in general. So Edison's real goal is not aesthetic or literary historicism. Just he tries to summarize the changing poetic style that's taking place. But ideologically, to defend himself and his profession against those who may wish to infiltrate the guild and impose upon those whose sensibilities are not as highly trained as to distinguish between what is good piece of writing and what is not. So this is the motive behind his writing, that he wants to draw a distinction or the difference between the ideological thought process or the sensibility that a writer takes into account. He goes on to identify certain pictures, poems, like some of the poems which would be in the form of an egg or in the form of an altar or in the form of a wing. So these are all the other types of falsehood, and he tries to criticize them for the derogative attitudes towards poetic art. So author of such a poem had to first draw the outline of the subject and which he intend to write upon, and afterwards confirm the description to the figure of his subject. So during his creative process, poetry is treated in an impermissible manner. That is, it is contracted or dilated itself, and it's molded accordingly. Like it's already given a shape, and in that we have to just put the artwork. So it's not that the artwork is normally written. Normally art is spontaneous and it goes in a flow, and it can't be just given a shape and that we need to fit in. So Edison even quotes Dryden's MacFlick, to support his position. And what was the support that he was taking from MacFlick by Dryden, that there's a quotation that choose for thy command some peaceful province in acrostic land, there mayst thou wings displays and altars raise and torture one poor word a thousand ways. So it's a sort of torture that we do to word by putting it into different frameworks like wings and altars. So this was his support point through the work of Dryden's MacFlick. Okay, so now we are heading towards the second essay on wit, and in here he tries to point out for the first time the social appeal of a wit when he says there is nothing more certain than that every man would be a wit if he could. So he's hinting at how it's increasing the very social attractiveness of the status of writer in the modern European culture. So those would be wits, that is the authors that are characterized for their wits, are inappropriately painful, and it's a futile attempt at establishing the status. So like one of the example that I would cite from the essay, that how one of the like the very struck the very representation of the person's name was through the figure that was used differently. Like for the Caesar, the figure of elephant was used upon the reverse of the public money, and even the case of Cicero, just a wench that was used, and the different images of frogs and the lizard figures that were used in the building structures. So these were the different ways or the different text or images that were taken into account. And he even takes it further and he says that it's the very characteristics of it that we say it's quite painful and futile attempt. And he even tries to take the title of the wit as it's a trifle, and man had better be a galley slave than a wit. And he goes on to identify some more forms of falsehood, like lipograms. That is a poem of, as I told you earlier, like in Ulysses or the Odysseys, how the very alphabets in the 24 books, one by one, it was not used or it was replaced, and that too intentionally. And so lipogram is there. Then rebus is a poem in which whole word is omitted and replaced by an image. Then there's an echo poem, and best example would be George Herbert's Heaven, that was written in 1633. So he quotes a number of work, and even he says that the work that we normally praise, Hudibras, that was written by Samuel Butler, it was not for the content matter, rather it was for this, it's quite doggerel rhymes, that it is quite appealing one. And even one of the most best example that could be cited would be how a poet who even didn't knew the name of the lady, and he just heard it as a lady, Mary Boone, and he toiled for day and night and for a year or two, and at last he did come out with a poetic work and changed it with Moll Boone, and he tried to present it to the lady love, and he then at last he came to know that it was not Boone, but it was rather Bohun. So it's quite fruitless effort that he put, and it didn't even satisfy his lover as well. So it's a kind of transmutation that we do with the words and even with the letters, and it's totally take a different turn. So the very use of elusive in the writings, it's a sort of rivalry with the words that we are trying to play. So it could be called the anagram of man rather of word, because human being is immersed in this task so diligently or so effortfully. Rather, poetry is an effortless task. It's just a flow of emotions. But when we try to mold it in a certain structure, it becomes quite industrious. It takes quite lots of pain in creating that. And the very structure of the poem that we, the very anagram that we say, that the first letter of the word that to taken in the perpendicular line, it conveys a meaning in itself. And even the relation that has been shown of German medalist Gustavus Adolphus, and through the reading of the line that the Christ versus Duxer triumph. So through the very line, we need to find out the age that it is telling about. So it is 1627, the year in which medal was stamped. So we need to inscribe or decipher the very lines, what it's trying to say, and through that we can identify the very year it is speaking of. Then the bouts rhymes, that was a favorite of the French nation, that do abound in wit and learning. So there's a list of words that are rhyme with one another and draw up by another lands and given to a poet who was to make poem to the rhymes in the same order. So they were placed up to the list, and it was a quite uncommon sort of rhyme, and it was more extraordinary with the genius of the poet that could accommodate his words to them. So there was a quite, we can identify, there's a great instance of a decay of we, there's a decay of wit, and there's a learning among the French, which generally follow the declension of empire, than the endeavoring to restore his foolish kind of wit. So by the example of the Mercury Gallant, where the author every month tries to give a list of rhymes, and it's quite ridiculous. By he from the month of November last, that he till November last, for succeedingly for a month he tried to collect and recollect, and the outcome was it's quite amazing one, or we would be laughing at that. It was just lorries, gurriers, Musset, Lisset, Caesar, Etendards, Howlett and Follett. So these are the rhymes that he was working upon, and that too for a month. he put on his effort in this task. There are innumerable examples that has been cited in this essay, like Munshi Gombot. He wrote a composition of this nature, and there was a following four rhymes like amaryllis, phyllis, main, on. So these were quite in desire of him to formulate a rhymes, and that too were the too common, and it was easy to put it into words. So the when he put it before the critics, so it was quite not appreciated, and it was just a words that he got the compliment as, and that too word to word it was translated. And how the very double mean, double rhymes that we take into Hoodie Bras, and how we relish the very work. It's just because of the doggerel rhyme, it's drawing its attention. Then heading towards how Edison associated the origin of these form of what he calls falsehood with the ancient Greek authors. But his criticism is directed at metaphysical poets who revived their poetic method purely for the sake of being witty. So the ancient authors or rulers respectively practiced this kind of wit for some actual purpose. For example, Ribbus, coin of Caesar, who placed the figure of elephant on reverse side of the coin. So the word Caesar meant elephant in Punic, and it was against law to place a private man's image on the coin. So this was the concept behind not displaying the image of the man concerned in the very portrayal of the stamp or the coin itself. So the Christian monk are identified as the main culprit of this vouch of falsehood in the beginning of the third essay on wit. So the monks were the master of learning in the early Christian period and took up to this kind of wit, which required time and industry, but no genius and capacity that was required. So they not only restored the ancient techniques of false wit, but they also cherished or enriched the world with inventions of their own. For example, anagram, which is nothing else, but it's a transmutation of one word into another, or just trying of the same set of words into different words. So which may change night into day or black into white, if chance shall so direct. So here, Ellison is trying to allude to the danger of the language that is employed in creative ways. It's quite a manipulation. It's a deformation of reality. And he also adds another feature of falsehood, that is, it's not guided by necessity or artistic or any other, but by it's a mere chance. And again, he emphasizes how it's quite disproportionately, the quantity is divested or invested into creation of this kind of writing. And he even recounts how a story of a man who is trying to come up with an anagram for his mistress name shut himself up for half a year before finally coming out with one. And like the type of the falsehood that he included in a chronogram that was favored by Germans, and bout rhyme that was favored by French. Now, heading towards the fourth paper on the wit, Edison mostly attacks the punning and discusses the battle between the ancients and the modern before mentioning the distinction between false and true wit for the first time. So for the first time, we come to know about the punning, and he stresses out or he asserts it out in the essay. Like punning is like a seed that has been implanted in the minds of all men. And though they may be subdued by reason, reflection, and good sense, they will be very apt to shoot up in the greatest genius that is not broken and cultivated by rules of art. So imitation is natural to us when it doesn't raise the mind to poetry, painting, music, or other more noble arts. So it often breaks out in puns and quibbles. So this was his view regarding the pun, that though we can subdue it with reason, reflection, and good sense, but it is quite natural, like an imitation that we normally do or we opt for, but it doesn't raise the mind like in poetry or painting or music. That's quite noble acts, and we need to break out from this sort of pun or quibbling. And he even quotes Aristotle, that the rhetoric that was the chapter 11, and who ranks paragram as a proof of good writing. According to Edison, the age that was most pun prone was the reign of James I, 1566 to 1625. And at that time, the time of Baroque poetry, Barnism, Gongorism, metaphysical poetry, etc. During this time, pun was delivered with great gravity from the pulpit or pronounced in the most solemn manner. manner at the council table. The pun infected the everyday speech and by extension the reality it says to respect the borders of its designated area of influence, such as just as Addison observes them in the sermon of Bishop Andrew and the tragedies of Shakespeare. These are full of pun. So thus the religious practices that was undermined by this subversive wit and the same rhetoric was used by a sinner to make repentance in the church as by an actor during a soliloquy on the stage. Addison is quite sarcastic about the famous university of this land and which was lately infested with puns and suggests ironically that the reason behind maybe the nearby fence and the marches are quite influencing the very effect of the pun. And defending the ancient authors who tried to use pun, but Addison says that they didn't knew any better. They were destitutes of rules and arts of criticism, and for that reason, they excel. They excel later writers in greatness of genius, but they fell short of them in accuracy and correctness. So there are different distinguishing levels of the several kinds of wit that was produced by the first race of writers, that were the ancients, and the task of a second race of authors, and they did not. They did so upon the criteria of their being founded in truth. So the second race of authors that we were talking about, they did so upon the criteria of their being founded just on the topic of truth. And truth was the very validatory point or the valid point that they used to consider, take into consideration. So ancient authors, apart from Quintilia or Longinus, they didn't know how to separate false and true wit. And because of being they didn't able to distinguish between the two, and they were not settled yet. So there was a dichotomy between the true and false wit that laid a core of the establishment of Augustine art criticism, and even then continues to locate and he then even tries to continue to locate the revival of false wit. So it hadn't happened about the it's happened about the time of the revival of letter, that is Renaissance. And but as soon as it was once detected, that it immediately vanished and disappeared. So Addison also tries to predict that it will one day be yet again revived in some distant period of time, as pedantry and ignorance will prevail upon wit and sense. So here wit is of course the right kind of wit, that is he says about the true wit, not on the false wit. And finally, when he tries at the end of the essay, he says that Addison defines pun as a conceit that arises from the use of two words that agree in sound but differs in the sense. If a piece of wit is true, it needs to stand the test of translation. And if it bears the test, you may pronounce it to be true, but if it vanishes in the experiment, one can conclude that it's just a pun. So he then likens the false wit to sound without sense and contrast it with the true wit whose essence lies in metaphorical like let her be dressed or undressed and all is one, she is excellent still. So the penultimate essay on wit starts by Edison quoting from Locke's essay on the difference between wit and judgment. Wit lying most in assemblage of ideas and putting those together with quickness and variety. Herein can be found any resemblance or congruity, thereby to make up pleasant pictures and agreeable visions in the essay. So on the other hand, we can say that judgment that lies in separating carefully one from the other, another, while ideas can be found in least differences. So thereby one can say that in order to avoid being misled by similitude and by affinity, so one need to take one thing for another. And in Locke's account, metaphor is associated with pleasantries of wit and fancy, and it is opposed to judgment and reason. So Edison approves of this definition of wit and adds that not every resemblance of ideas is what we call wit. So unless it be such as one that give delight and surprise to the reader. So these two properties seems essentials to wit, more particularly the last of them. So the idea shouldn't lie too near one another in the nature of things, for when the likeness is obvious, it gives no surprise. So apart from the obvious resemblances that we run after, some further congruity must also be discovered in the two ideas that is capable of giving the reader some surprise. So Edison then tries to define true wit is a resemblance of ideas, while false wit is a resemblance of single letter, that is anagrams, chronograms, lipograms, acrostics. So sometimes of syllable, equipoems, doggerel rhymes, sometimes of words, that is pun and quibbles, and sometimes of whole sentence or poem, that is a picture poem, and proceed to introduce a third type of wit, that is a mixed wit. So consisting partly in the resemblance of ideas and partly in the resemblance of words, so the kind of wit abounds in so the kind of wit that that is abounded in works of Cowley, Waller, the Italians, occasionally Dryden's work, while Milton, Spenser, Bulow, most of the ancient Greeks and above it. So there's a mixed wit has innumerable branches, and it is a composition of pun and true wit that makes it a mixed wit. So Edison disagrees with Dryden's famous definition of true wit just as a propriety of words and thoughts that is adapted to the subject. So this definition Edison contends and is applicable to a good writing in general. So as George Williamson points out that Edison misquotes Dryden here, but the misquoting emphasizes the opposition between Edison's position and earlier perception of wit. So for Dryden, according to Edison's misreading, wit can be tested by looking at the work itself, by assessing the proportions between word and thought. So for himself, Edison turns to Locke's definition of wit as just lying most in the assemblage of ideas and putting those together with quickness and variety, wherein can be found any resemblance or congruity, thereby to make a pleasant picture in the fancy. So Edison modifies his definition as well as in order to further emphasize an effective psychology. Every resemblance of ideas is not that which we call wit, unless it be such as one that gives delight and surprise to the reader. So Edison appeals beyond the formal qualities of the work to the mechanism of the mind, and devote a part of the following section to the element of surprise and its significance in the aesthetic theory. Edison did agree with Dominic Bohan's that no thought can be beautiful, that is not just and does not have its foundation in the nature of things. So the basis of all wit is truth, and no thought can be valuable of which good sense is not the groundwork. So Bulu is also a supporter of this principle, which is the natural way of writing, that beautiful simplicity which we so admire in composition of ancients. So this ability stems from the strength of genius. So those who lack in it try to compensate for it with foreign ornaments. And Edison compares these authors to gods in poetry, who, like those in architecture, try to supply beautiful simplicity with all the extravagancies of an irregular fancy. So doubting the taste of English poets as well as readers and calling it extremely gothic, he quotes Dryden, who in turn quotes Jan Regnault de Segrais, who distinguishes the readers of poetry according to the capacity of judging into three classes. So Edison only quotes the first lowest class of the reader, the rabble of readers, in other words, who prefer a quibble, a conceit, an epigram before solid sense and elegant expression. So these are mob readers. And in the very last paragraph, Edison returns to Locke's definition of wit and expands it by suggesting that not only the resemblance but the opposition of ideas does very often provide wit. So however, he doesn't provide details of this suggestion, nor does he give any example, stating only that he may possibly enlarge upon this topic in some future speculation. So in the last essay of wit, Edison recounts his last night allegorical dream of several schemes of wit. So in his dreams, he enters region of falsehood that is governed by goddesses of falsehood. And nothing in these lands appear natural. Trees blossoms in leaf gold, produce bone lace and precious stones. And the fountain bubble in opera tunes are filled with stags, wild boars and mermaids, dolphins and fish play on banks and meadows. So the birds have human voice. Winds are filled with sighs and message of distant lovers. Edison ventures upon a gothic building in a desert forest, and it turns out to be a heathen temple of the god of dullness. So God is surrounded by his worshippers, that is industry and caprice. So there is an altar that is covered in offerings of axes, wings, cuts and papers, and inscribed with verses, picture poems. So the votaries present include a regiment of anagrams, body of acrostics, then the file of chronograms, then the phantom of Trifudorus and the lipogrammatist. So all engaging in pastime like rebus, crambo, double rhyme. So outside the temple, Edison passes by a party of puns. And on his way out of the region, he meets goddesses of truth, whose arrival is signaled by a very shining light. So on her right side, there marched a male deity who bore several quivers on his shoulder and grasped several arrows in his hand. So his name was Wit, and the frontiers of the enchanted region were inhabited by the species of mixed Wit, who made a very odd appearance when they were mustered together in an army. So he goes on to describe the members of the species as follows. So there were men whose bodies were stuck full of darts, and the women whose eyes were burning glasses, men that had hearts of fire, and women that had breasts of snow. So this big groups divided up into two parts, one half throwing themselves behind the banners of truth and the other half behind the banner of falsehood. So the brightness of truth makes falsehood fade away, and with her, the whole army shrunk into nothing. And the temple sings, fountain recovers their murmur, birds their voices, trees their leaves, and the whole face of nature is become true and genuine appearance seems. So then Edison inspects the army of true wit. So there is the genius of heroic poetry, tragedy, satire, rhetoric, comedy, epigram, who marched up at the rear and who had been posted there at the beginning of the expedition that he might not revolt to the enemy whom he was suspected to favor in his heart. So Edison is very much awed and delighted with the appearance of the god of wit, for there was something so amiable and yet so piercing in his looks that he feels himself inspired with love and terror. The god offers his quiver of arrows as a present to Edison, who, reaching his hand to accept it, it knocks it against the chair and wakes up. So there's a quite ambiguity and surprise that can be noticed in Edison's aesthetic work. Like we talked about, a true wit is nothing else but a similitude in ideas. So is false wit with the similitude of words. So whether it lies in the likeness of letters only, as in anagrams or acrostics, or whole, the very pun, echoes, and the like. So besides these two kinds of the true and a false wit, there is another, the mixed trick that we talked about, and wherein two ideas that have some resemblance with each other and are both expressed by the same word, and we make use of ambiguity of the word to speak that of one idea included under it, so which is proper to the other. And most language have hit on the word which properly signifies fire to express love, and therefore we may be sure there is some resemblance in the ideas mankind have of them. So from hence the witty poems of all language, when they have once called love a fire and consider it no longer a passion, but speaks of it under the notion of a real fire, and as the turn of wit requires, makes the same word in the same sentence stand for either of the ideas that is annexed to it, and even goes on to criticize the middle kind of the wit that has its ambiguities and the very double entendre of the romance of the restoration comedy for moral reasons. So Joseph Edison, being one of the great critic and social reformer during the regime of Queen Anne, and he was very well known as an English essayist, poet, playwright, and politician, and he did possess multidimensional qualities, and he achieved social name and fame during his lifetime, especially as a social reformer, and he did contribute towards the society as a social reformer, and it cannot be described, because he is also famous not only for the literary, so the Spectator magazines, his life along with his lifelong friend Richard Steele, so he did had a lots and lots of contribution in the society. So during his time, at the rate of immorality in the society that became acute, he took the privilege to study the human behavior. So Edison was not only the only critic who knew the best how to ridicule about anybody without causing a wound. So he was the one who never tried to inflict wound upon the people. So though his mild satires, he tried to correct the society, and he belonged to the contemporaries. So he did belong to that contemporaries. His contemporaries were Pope, Dryden, Defoe, who were the satirists, but they were very personal in the satire, like Pope's Rape of the Lock and then Cn, and the another instances of the personal satires in Dryden's Absalom and Achitophel. So Addison never did satirize anything in order to inflict a serious wound on the mankind. And through this essay too, he made an attempt or an effort to make the clarification or the draw lines between what is true wit, what actually wit is, and what are the different types of wit that he has discussed in this essay particularly. And he tried even showed the conflict that were between the rural feudalism and urban manner in a brilliant way. So through the spectator, it's a picture of Edison himself, and his essays are quite neat, and it's quite lucid in the language. It's quite polished in phrases, and it's itself a perfect one. And the style can be called as a middle flight by Johnson, and his style of the essays contains lots and lots of meaning, and it's quite conveys meaning and knowledge, and it doesn't have any sorts of obscurity in it. And even it received different praises by it, such as for his work, like as a critic, Edison satirizes a society in good and humored way. So he was like a judge who castigates only in smiling. So he uses less contempt and more malevolence. So he uses his power to satirize through character of Roger when he observes there is no one in the town where he lives, so that he is not sued. And taking into consideration the very style, it's quite simple, lucid, and it contains it's going to be termed as a perfect, and it's quite convey the meaning in a simple manner. Through the reading of this essay, we did came to know about the different ways how the very concept of wit and judgment in the time of John Locke, he tried to make a distinction between the two, and how with the help of wit, it's and not through the use of pun or anagrams, the very value of literary works increases, and it do add value to the work in itself. And there was different and lots of allusions and references were made to the different work and the writers. Even the references of Cicero, Caesar, and Dryden all did contributed in his work a best sort of example. So hopefully you might have understood some of the points regarding the essays. So we are good to wind the session. Thank you to one and all.
Thank you, ma'am.